Let us place ourselves in the presence of the Lord. Alright, good afternoon. This is the last session. And we have to go a little bit faster because we are not given sufficient time. If you will ask me, it would have been appropriate that we had four at least sessions. We only have 12 hours to finish the book two. That is too short. But anyway, let us make the most out of the period given to us. I could hardly catch my breath because I walked from first floor up to the fifth floor. I already had my workout this morning, and again, I will have another one this afternoon in the class. So, let me just start by asking you, do you still, I hope most of you here are Catholics, right? And do you still confess your sins? Yes. No more? You do not confess anymore? Okay. If you confess, what happens after confession? Absolution ka agad. Penance muna. You see? You are given a penance and you have to do this whatever penance is given before the absolution. See? And do you know that the priest also confess their sins? Yes. Kasi I was contemplating this matter of Station of the Cross when I was going upstairs five floors as if I made a Station of the Cross. And I recall this happened one time when a priest confessed his sins. He confessed his sin to another priest, of course. So, bless me, Father, for I have sinned, etc., etc. After the confession, the priest said, the confessor said, what is my penance? And the confessant said, your penance is to make a Station of the Cross. And for each Station of the Cross, pray the rosary. That was the penance. All right? 3 days thereafter, the confessor becomes the confessant. In other words, there was a change of position. So, confessor becomes the confessor. He confesses sins, and after the confession, he asks, what is my penance? And the priest said, your penance is pray the rosary. Thank you, Father. Wait. Pray the rosary, but for each bead of the rosary, make a Station of the Cross. For its bead of the rosary, make a Station of the Cross. You know, you'll notice, class, that you will simply reverse the wordings of your statement. It will totally change or alter your answer. So, in the bar exam, see to it that the words, your answers, are coherently fixed. Otherwise, it might give a different meaning. Yesterday we were talking about kidnapping, last paragraph 267. And we said that if the intention of the accused is to kidnap or detain the victim, and there is a subsequent killing or rape, such will constitute as a special complex crime. Supposing there are several killings, there is only one crime of kidnapping with homicide. Okay, of course, these several killings will constitute a separate offense, because in kidnapping class, for each victim will constitute a separate crime. If there are two victims, then two counts of kidnapping. And if the victim was raped or the victim was killed, then two counts also of kidnapping with homicide. I am bringing this jurisprudence to your attention to distinguish it from abduction with rape, where there were several rapes committed after the abduction. In kidnapping with rape, if there are several rapes committed against the same woman victim, there is one crime of kidnapping with rape, special complex crime. On the contrary class, if it is abduction with rape, abduction being a necessary means to commit the crime of rape, and thereafter several rapes were committed against the same woman, do you apply the same rule as regards kidnapping with rape? The answer is no. Because when the first rape was consummated, there is already a crime of abduction with rape. The subsequent rape class will no longer be composite with the, is no longer composite with the crime of abduction, or no longer, not composite, excuse me, because composite technically has a meaning, will no longer be complex with abduction, should be complex. Now, what will happen to these other rapes? It will be a separate offense. Thus, there are as many crimes of rape as there are number of counts committed. Okay? Unlike in kidnapping, there is only one special complex crime, composite crimes. All right. Notice or take attention with Article 268, slight illegal detention. Slight illegal detention. Of course, it is slight when the circumstances under 267 are not present. Okay? And note, class, that once the victim is a woman or a minor, automatically it is a crime of serious illegal detention, independent of the period of detention. Independent of the period of detention. And this matter of mitigating circumstance regarding the the accused who did not persist with his intention to detain, and that is, he did not achieve his purpose, that is a mitigating circumstance only for purposes of slight illegal detention. It does not apply to 267. the person who furnishes or owns the place where the detention was committed or the detention was made, class, is an accomplice. Is an accomplice. In slight illegal detention, he is not merely an accomplice, but he is also a principal. He is a principal. Only in 268. Okay? 268. Regarding this kidnapping and failure to return a minor, take note, class, that the crime is plain and simple failure to return a minor. It is not kidnapping. There is no such kidnapping here. Because here, the minor was initially or inceptionally entrusted to the accused. And he failed to return the victim to the trustor. This is the essence of failure to return a minor. Okay. We jump to 270, 271, 72. If you will notice, these are specific crimes of coercion involving a minor. Relate these specific coercions and crimes committed against a minor with your Republic Act 7610, because these acts may already constitute a violation of 7610, abuse against minors or children, child abuse in other words. All right. So 274, 75 regarding abandonment. Regarding abandonment, just take note, class, that abandonment, if it is by dolo, meaning the crime committed was done intentionally, and the victim was abandoned, what is the effect of abandonment? There is none. There is none. You are not required to give some help to your victim when it is an unintentional felony. Negligent act. For instance, the accused was driving negligently and hit a pedestrian. The accused has the duty to help the victim. If he does not render or he does not help the victim, class, it is considered a qualifying circumstance. What do I mean by qualifying circumstance? It increases the penalty. Do not use the word aggravating circumstance when he does not render any help or succor to the victim. Why did I say do not use the word aggravating? Why? Because crimes committed by culpa are not mitigated or aggravated by Articles 13 and Article 14. Articles 13 and 14. Aggravating and mitigating circumstances are applicable only to crimes committed by dolo. That is why I said qualifying circumstance and did not say aggravating. The word aggravating again has a technical meaning. Now, the abandonment which is penalized here under 275 is the abandonment done by a person who had accidentally injured a victim. Accidentally injured a victim. So that if the accused abandoned such accidentally injured victim, he is not entitled to the justifying circumstance. Is it justifying accident? No. It is still an exempting circumstance, paragraph 4, article 12. Article 12. It is an exempting circumstance. He is not entitled but liable for abandonment. So that if the abandoned victim consequently dies, what happened? He is liable now for homicide because of the act of abandonment applying Article 4, Paragraph 1. Article 4, paragraph 1, any person committing a felony shall be liable to the logical, necessary consequence or natural consequence of his act, although he did not intend the same. All right? We have discussed this matter of trespass to dwelling. What is this trespass to dwelling? Of course, we relate this to a violation of domicile. Note again, class, that the trespass must be done against the will of the owner, so that the mere entry inside the house does not constitute trespass. There must be a prohibition. This prohibition may either be constructive or actual. Of course, as I have said, if it is in the evening, nobody would like a visitor to come in. In which case, there is a constructive prohibition. Constructive prohibition. Supposing there was somebody who allowed the trespasser to get in the house, is the trespasser liable for a crime? The answer is no. So long as there is a person who give consent, so long as this person is of age or can give possibly a consent of mature age, the maid, for instance, can. But supposing the maid was prohibited to give consent to anyone who get inside the house. All right. But nonetheless, the maid allowed somebody to get inside the house. There is no trespass to dwelling if the trespasser is not aware of the prohibition. But if the trespasser is aware of the prohibition, notwithstanding the consent given by the occupant, the maid, does not matter. He is liable for trespass to dwelling. Of course, you know what is the definition of a dwelling, okay? You know the definition of a dwelling. Take note also the instance when dwelling becomes an aggravating circumstance and not simply a separate offense. Of course, sometimes when somebody is killed in the house, more often than not, it is already homicide aggravated by dwelling. But class, if initially trespass is the intention and the killing was only incidental when he was about to escape and refused to leave the premises, then from here you can distinctly make a different offense, which are trespass to dwelling and that of homicide. Okay. Let us take this matter of coercion and threats quickly. 282, 283, and 285. Threats is grave. When do we say that a threat is grave? All right. It is grave, light, and others. Okay. Which means it is also considered as a light threat. It is a grave threat, class, when the threat constitute a crime with or without any condition. I will kill you if you will not deliver a car tomorrow. That is a threat with a condition. I will kill you tomorrow. That is a threat without a condition. It involves the commission of a crime. The second kind of threat is a light thread, which must be done with a condition. Sometimes this is referred to as blackmail or extortion. Did you see this cell phone? I have taken a picture last night. You and a woman very sweetly having a drinking at a certain bar in Makati, and there was even a kissing scene. I will show this to your wife, but I will not do that if you can spare me some 500,000 pesos. All right. There is a threat not constituting a crime, but it imposes a condition. I will report you to the BIR for non-payment of taxes. But if you will spare me 100,000, then that would be all right. No, I will not make a report. I will report this matter to the dean if you will not come with me tonight. Those are light threats punishable under Article 83, because this is 282. Okay? 283. 285 are other light threats not falling under paragraph 1 or paragraph 2. Notice the first kind of threat. It may even involve a future crime of robbery. Yes, robbery. I will kill you if you will not bring your money tomorrow. See? Give me 100 pesos tomorrow. Otherwise, I will kill you. Deliver to me. That is a kind of robbery, but it is not robbery because it is future in character. It is merely a grave threats with a condition. The others are light threats. During a quarrel class, you draw a weapon, but you do not persist with the threat. Or during a time when you are angry, you threatened somebody with a crime, but you did not persist. Those are other light threats. Okay? Other light threats. And if you will distinguish this from coercion, which may either also be grave or light. All right. Note, class, that coercion does not simply involve an act of compulsion. Grave threat, when there is a force or intimidation in order to compel a person to commit an act. A compulsion is one where you require the doing of a certain act. It may also involve prohibition. Prohibit somebody prohibit somebody to do an act with force and intimidation, that is grave coercion. But notice, class, when it is compulsion, you compel somebody to do an act which is right, that is grave coercion. You compel somebody to do an act which is wrong, is that a coercion? The answer is also yes. Whether or right or wrong, you compel someone to do this act, that is grave coercion. On the other hand, if you prohibit somebody to do a rightful act, is that coercion? Yes, because he had the right to do that thing, because it is not illegitimate, it is legitimate. However, this time, if it is a wrongful act which you prohibit, it will not constitute a coercion. See? Why? Because you have the right to prevent the doing of a wrongful act. Perhaps there may be another crime committed, if ever there is any, but not grave coercion. Light coercion may either be taking of a property to offset a debt from the debtor. Okay? Take the property of your debtor, because by a creditor, the act of a creditor, taking the property of the debtor to offset his indebtedness is a light coercion. And other light coercion is what you term as unjust vexation. Okay. This is 287. Union unjust vexation. Anything that will cause you irritating, that will cause you, that will irritate you, that will vex you, that is vexatious act, which is unjust vexation, penalized as light coercion, specifically under 287. Okay? Now, I will let us get some specific application. The accused said, "Give me your bag." Coercion. "Do not enter this room." Coercion. "You called somebody, do not attend your class today. If you will do so, you will die." Pare, huwag kang pumasok mamaya. Yung asawa mo, may mangyayari pag ikaw ay pumasok. Pare, huwag kang papasok dito. Pag pumasok ka, tepok ka. Will your answer make any difference? Will it be coercion? Threat? All right. The threat or the coercion to take the bag, is that coercion? All right. If there is an intent to gain, it is not coercion. Crime, plain and simple, robbery, because of the force and intimidation, where you are doing to take the bag if it will not be delivered to you immediately. Note that the delivery as well as the infliction of the force or violence are immediate in character. Give me your bag, otherwise I will kill you. Deliver your bag tomorrow, otherwise I will kill you. Grave threat with a condition, because the delivery as well as the threat or violence are still in the future. Do not come here inside, otherwise I will kill you. Threat with a condition or coercion. It is a crime of coercion. Why? Because the condition is immediate, not to enter this room, as well as the infliction of the violence is likewise immediate. Do not enter this room, otherwise you get killed. Coercion, prohibition. Pare, mamayang huwag ka nang pumasok ngayon, otherwise mamamatay si commander. The threat as well as the condition to come to the class are both future. It is a crime of threat. Okay? So that discussion take care of threats as well as coercion. We proceed to title 9. We proceed to title 9. I hate this kind of work. As I told you before, yesterday, one time I attended a seminar abroad in Japan, and I was the rapporteur of the group. Because I was then I was the lowest ranking officer, so I was designated the rapporteur. You know what is a rapporteur? He is the one who will prepare the reports. So when there was a lecture, I hurriedly take down these lectures, because immediately after writing on the whiteboard, the lecturer will push a button, and immediately, everything in the whiteboard is obliterated. So I have to catch up doing that the whole day. And then, when it is about 5 o'clock, what the lecturer asked. He asked, how many are you in the room? And we counted off, 1, 2, 3, 20, sir. And then the lecturer again pushed a button, and all the things that were written in the whiteboard from the morning until the end of the day were reproduced. And each one of us were given a copy. That is an experience, unforgettable experience. And every time I make a lecture, that is always my wish. I hope we could also have that kind, where it will immediately be erased, and after the end of the day, each one of you will be given a copy of what were written in the whiteboard, so that you will not write anymore. I do not know if that time will come, maybe 10 more years when you are already a lawyer, a seasoned lawyer, because it will only take you 5 years to become a seasoned lawyer with Ajinomoto. All right. Robbery. Let us discuss the elements of robbery. What is the first element? Intent to gain. All right. Animus furandi. Later on, when we take up this matter of special complex crime, you will notice that all of these crimes related thereto, in order to apply the articles provided in Title 10, the primary intention of the accused is to gain. Intent to gain. If there is no intent to gain, there may be a crime of grave coercion. Grave coercion. Although there are some a little bit modifications, as for instance, when the possessor, wait. When the offender is the owner, yes, he does not ordinarily commit a crime of robbery. Why? Because there is no intent to gain, because that is the property of the owner. But there is, or there are some modification. Like for instance, the possessor is possessing the property with a legal right. As for instance, he is leasing the property. All right? The taking by another person may be a crime if done by the owner himself. In one case where the property was pledged, yes, and it was taken by the pledger, from the pledgee, who has the right of possession, legal right of possession over the property. What crime is committed? Would it be robbery if it was taken by the owner? All right. This will constitute now a crime of estafa, because the possessor has a legal right over the property and the owner took it from the pledgee. It is a crime of estafa, I think 316 paragraph 3. What is the next? Taking. Unlawful taking. It must be taken by the accused from the owner. A question crop up whether the taking would be permanent or temporary. Class, whether you want to dispossess the owner temporarily or permanently, so long as it is an appreciable length of time, you had in effect dispossessed the owner and prevented him from the enjoyment of the property. Thus, if you prevent him from enjoyment of his property, there is taking, even if it is temporary in character. There was an issue before that it is not a crime of theft or robbery if the property was delivered to the accused. If the property was delivered to the accused, there is no taking, and therefore it cannot be a crime of theft or robbery. The answer is that is not correct, or that is not accurate. Why? Because even if it is delivered, there is still taking that would amount to a crime of theft if what was delivered is the material possession. In fact, this possession will distinguish whether it is theft or whether it is estafa. We'll take that up later. It's still premature. But nonetheless, I am just introducing you already. this matter of physical and juridical possession. And then personal property. In criminal law class, the definition of a personal property is not the same as that in your civil code. Because in criminal law, anything that can be appropriated, that can be the subject of taking, apoderamiento, is considered as a personal property. In fact, even a real property defined under your civil code may be the subject of robbery or theft. Like for instance, the fish in the fish pond. Like for instance, machineries attached to the building. If these are removed, these machineries, they can be the subject of robbery or theft and are considered personal property. Perhaps it is timely that I will discuss the other kinds of personal property subject of theft or robbery but may constitute another crime. For instance, if the subject matter is a motor vehicle, would it be robbery? Would it be theft? Plus, I am interchanging robbery or theft because at this 1, 2, 3, this is a crime of theft. The fourth element would make a crime of robbery. What is the fourth one? Force. Okay. I will suspend the discussion of force. Meantime, the subject matter of personal property. If it is a vehicle, what are the possible crimes committed? Carnapping. Okay. 6359, 6359, I'm not sure. Republic Act 6359, carnapping if it involved a motor vehicle. Is that the only possible crime if the subject matter is a motor vehicle? The answer is no. It may also amount to a qualified theft under 310. When? All right. This time, when the motor vehicle was delivered to the accused, given with the consent of the accused. But what was given or transferred is only the physical or material possession. So that if it is a juridical possession class, this taking of motor vehicle or delivery of this motor vehicle may amount to a crime of estafa. As for instance, in a case where you lease a motor vehicle and failure to return it, the lessee has gained a juridical possession over the property. Okay? But lease of a public utility vehicle, there is no lessor-lessee relationship, but only material possession. Large cattle. What is the possible crime committed? All right. 310 in relation to your cattle rustling law, PD 533. This presidential decree class did not amend or did not repeal by the Article 310. It did not repeal. It merely imposed a higher penalty. Okay? Of course, class, it may still involve estafa if there is a juridical possession. Okay? What are the others? Mail matter.
male matter.
It may be infidelity in the custody of document under 226 if it was done by the person in custody. It may be qualified theft under 310. It may also be a qualified robbery if it falls under the last paragraph of Article 302, in which case the penalty is increased. Last paragraph of 302. Then you have documents. Documents that has a value. This is a special form of robbery defined under Article 298, compelling a person to execute a document that has a value like a mortgage or a deed of sale is a special crime of robbery defined under Article 298. These are the more important articles or property. There are other provisions penalizing this crime involving a personal property. For instance, regarding the theft of electricity, theft of gold bars is also governed by special law. Lately, in that case of Valenzuela versus Judge Abrugar, when telephone, international telephone calls, where the accused or suspect, had taken advantage of these PLDT lines in order to sell these loads, and those buyers can call or make an international call. All right. This is a kind of theft involving the business of providing international call services. Okay. This is a business which is also the subject of theft. If you only read the first decision of the Supreme Court sometime in 2006, that decision said that it is not a theft because it is not contemplated by the revised penal code. But on a motion for reconsideration, the Supreme Court said it is a theft because the business of providing international call services is also a property subject matter of theft. Valenzuela versus Judge Abrugar. Okay? And finally, force, the use of force. The use of force, which may either be person or things. Force or violence against person and force upon things, governed by 294 up to 298 and things 298 up to 302. All right. Robbery with force and intimidation against person and robbery with force upon things. When is robbery consummated? All right. Insofar as robbery with force and intimidation against person, it is consummated the moment the accused acquired possession. It is not necessary that the offender is given the opportunity to dispose. Teka. This is the case of Valenzuela, where the Supreme Court said that there is no crime of frustrated robbery, frustrated theft. And in People versus Salvilla, the Supreme Court said there is no frustrated robbery. Okay, why? Because upon the possession of the thing placed under his control, it is automatically consummated. Okay, disposition is immaterial, so that there is no in between. It is either taken or not. So attempted and consummated. Regarding that business of international service calls, that is the case of Laurel versus Abrugar. Sorry, Laurel versus Abrugar. Okay, I just mix these things because I was thinking the next point where the penalty for robbery with force against person and things. It is possible, class, that both element of force or intimidation against person, and at the same time there is a force and intimidation upon things. Yes, as for instance, the accused through the window entered the building and then killed the victim inside, or committed robbery with force or intimidation against person. If that is so, what is the basis of the penalty? Would it be robbery with force upon things or against person under 294 to 298 or 299 to 302? Of course, the Supreme Court said in Napoles versus Court of Appeals, if those two elements of robbery concur, it becomes a wala, sumasagot. Hindi yata alam. Napoles, nandyan lahat sa mga libro ninyo. Complex crime. Pag yan ay nagdalawa. 294 to 298 define a crime of robbery where there is only force and intimidation against person. Things, okay. Take note, class. I will not discuss this anymore. Take note that dependent upon the building, nature of the building, whether it is inhabited or uninhabited, the mode of commission may be modified. The mode of commission, whether it is inhabited or uninhabited, are the same but one, meaning there is only one exception. What is that exception? The use of fictitious name or abuse of authority. That mode is applicable only to an inhabited house. Because if it is uninhabited, saan mo gagamitin yung fictitious name? Hence, for example, in a warehouse, the accused pretended to be a public officer, an engineer who is inspecting the building and was able to gain entry inside the warehouse and took the things inside surreptitiously. Crime committed. Of course, it could not be robbery, but a crime of theft only, because it is uninhabited. It would be different if it is inhabited, because that is one of the mode of committing a crime of robbery with force upon things involving an inhabited house. All right. Unlawful entry, the entry is done in an opening not intended for ingress or egress. Okay. Forcible entry, entering the building by means of force or violence, destruction of the wall, destruction of the door, destruction of the window, destruction of the ceiling to gain an entry. Remember that. Because if the window was destroyed or the window was used only to pick the things inside the house, that is a plain and simple theft and not a robbery. The accused must enter the building to constitute a crime of robbery with force upon things. Of course, there are two other modes where you do not need this violence. to enter. If the accused already entered, there are two modes. When the cabinet or the door to that chest or cabinet is also destroyed, that will constitute force upon things. Oy. Again, this job of erasing these things is one of the most potent potential question in the bar exam. All right. Your article 294. Which contains 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 paragraphs. Is there a crime of robbery with serious physical injury? Is there a crime of robbery with less serious physical injury? Is there a crime of robbery with mutilation? Is there a crime of robbery with arson? Under Article 294 class, there are 5 modes of committing it. When a robbery is committed with homicide, rape, mutilation, or arson, or under paragraph 263, paragraph 1, paragraph 2, serious physical injury defined under paragraph 1 and paragraph 2. And then you have less serious physical injury and serious physical injury, which are not defined under paragraph 1 and paragraph 2, and other physical injuries. All right. Why did I make this illustration? Because the wordings of your law, paragraph 1, 2, and 3 provides that if these are the force or violence committed, it must be by reason or on occasion. But if it is this paragraph 4 and paragraph 5, then in the course of commission, is there any relevance or significance of these terms? The answer is yes, very significant. If it is in the course or commission, these physical injuries or force and intimidation against person must be done before or during the crime of robbery. Before or during. If the robbery has already been consummated and the property was already taken, and subsequently there is slight physical injury inflicted, there is a less serious physical injury inflicted, it becomes a separate offense because it is no longer a necessary means. So that the taking would be plain and simple crime of theft. Theft. As for instance, the accused took it without you knowing it, your bag, and then ran away. You chase him. and inflicted slight physical injury. However, if homicide or this kind of physical injuries were inflicted, it becomes a special complex crime. It becomes a composite crime. It becomes a special indivisible crime. When do we say then that a crime is by reason or on occasion? All right. The Supreme Court said that the injuries or intimidation is by reason or on occasion class if it is intended to secure the property or loot, it is intended to prevent the discovery of the crime, it is intended to facilitate the commission of the crime, see? Prevent the discovery or kill or prevent the witnesses. These are instances where it could be said that this violence were committed by reason or on occasion, so that they may occur before, during, or after, so long only that the intent primarily is to commit robbery. The accused went to the house of the victim to commit robbery. He saw the maid tempted by the voluptuous body of the woman, raped the woman, then committed robbery. It's still robbery with rape. But of course, if it can be shown that his intention is to rape, then it becomes a separate crime. If it was not his original intention to commit robbery, but rape was the intention. How do you know that? Well, it will all depend upon the facts of the case. Is there a crime of robbery with multiple homicide? Is there a crime of robbery with multiple rapes? Once there is homicide committed, these are all either absorbed or becomes aggravating circumstance. There could be no robbery with homicide with rape. Once this, there is no homicide, there is rape, these matters become a matter of aggravating circumstances. Of course, you are aware of the case of People versus Rigala and subsequent cases where the Supreme Court said that the subsequent killings, the subsequent rapes, cannot be considered an aggravating circumstance. Why? Because there is no law providing that these crimes, additional rapes, additional homicide, are aggravating circumstances. Nullum crimen, nulla poena sine lege. There must be a law that would provide that these additional killing, additional rapes, be aggravating circumstances. Otherwise, said the Supreme Court, we will be dealing with judicial legislation. There must be a law. So at present now, this cannot constitute as an aggravating circumstance analogous to cruelty in case of additional death, analogous to ignominy in case of additional rape. The word homicide is used in its generic sense, so that even if there is sororicide, there is homicide, there is infanticide, there is parricide, plain and simple crime of robbery with homicide. Even if there was a culpable felony caused the death, is still a homicide. Even if the victim was one of the robbers, homicide, robbery with homicide. Even if it was the policeman who was killed, robbery with homicide. Even if it was the policeman who killed his fellow policeman, it is still robbery with homicide, so long as there is somebody who was killed in the course or in the commission of robbery. Okay? Oh, maliwanag na yan. Lumabas ito. Last year, the other year, it was us again. The other year, lumabas again. It is 90 percent batting average. I said yesterday that in all special complex crime, the composite crime is always consummated. Rape with homicide, but the intended crime may be attempted or frustrated. In Article 297, is that provision defines a special complex crime involving attempted robbery with homicide. With homicide. In like manner, the word homicide is also used in its generic sense. However, if there is a higher penalty for this homicide, what happened? The penalty for the higher crime, the penalty for that crime, meaning the higher penalty, will be imposed. Example, if the killing would constitute parricide, infanticide, then it is the penalty for parricide, infanticide, or murder, which will be imposed. That is the difference. And that person killed must not be a member of the, or must not be a one of the offenders. Must not be one of the offenders. Unlike in 294, robbery with homicide, it includes the offender. Okay? People versus Puno distinguish a plain and simple robbery from robbery committed in the highway, punishable under PD 532, highway robbery. Of course, the Supreme Court said if there is a specific victim, plain and simple robbery. If there is no specific victim, but anyone in the highway, then it becomes a highway robbery under PD 532. And then you have this matter of a band. Take note the effect of a band. If there is a band in the commission of robbery, four armed malefactor, wag yun ang gamitin yung less than, more than three. It's quite complicated. Sometimes there are people who don't know what is more than three. Gaya ng mga MMDA na nandyan sa labas, naghahanap ng mga looking for this number coding. They do not know what is an even and odd number. See? They cannot distinguish. Ano ba sir yung odd at saka even? Anyway, hindi naman ho odd even ang ating number coding. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 0. Yun lang. Alright. When there is a band class, all assaults committed is also the liability of all the members of the band. The only exception is when they prevent the commission of that assault. Robbery with homicide, all of them will be liable. Robbery with rape, there is an assault against a woman. It is not among their plan. It is not among their plan. Of course, if they tolerated robbery with rape. But here, class, if it's committed by a band, automatically, whether it is the direct, natural consequence of the crime of robbery, they are all liable for all the assault committed by the band unless they prevented the commission of the assault. In one case, robbery, the victim took the woman away from the place of the crime and raped the victim. It was not a case of robbery with rape as regards the other members of the band.
Why? Because it was away from the place of the robbery. There is no possibility that they could prevent. But if it was inside the building, then they will be all liable. They will be all liable. Okay? So robbery, theft, we have discussed already. In effect, when we discuss the elements of robbery, the only difference is that there is no force and intimidation. Plus the other kind of theft, where it involves a lost property, all right? Lost property, and you did not return this to the proper authority, that is also theft. Or in a case of malicious mischief, where the accused took possession used by the accused of that property which was destroyed. Okay. Let us go to estafa. Estafa again. Very important. 3, 1, 5. Paragraph 1, paragraph 2, and paragraph 3. Estafa. One, estafa through abuse of confidence, and the second one is by means of fraud or deceit. These are the only two kinds of estafa, generally. And under paragraph one, you have A, B, and C. And then fraud and deceit, you have number two, number three, A, B, C, D, A, B, C. Never mind. All right. As regards the first paragraph, madalian, alteration of the quantity, quality of the object, subject of an onerous obligation. Take note of the words onerous. All right. Paragraph 1B, abuse of confidence. This one is the most difficult, but we will simplify the application of 1B, because it is in this kind of estafa where there is a contract that is created between the accused and the offender, because the thing is delivered by reason of a commission, administration, etc., etc., etc. In other words, there is the so-called prestation on the part of the accused, such that it is in this kind of estafa now class that you will determine the kind of possession which was transferred to the offender or accused. What kind of possession was acquired in that contractual obligation? Whether is it material possession or physical possession, so that the crime would be only a crime of theft? Or would it be juridical possession, where that kind of possession will be invoked even as against the owner? Why? Because he has a possession which is juridical in character. There is a legal bind that he can put out even us against the owner. And finally,
a possession of an owner. If the possession that was transferred is that kind of an ownership, no crime committed, but there is only a civil liability. All right. Civil liability. In a juridical possession class, there is actually a contract. A contract. And this kind of contract, example, lease agreement. You rent. All right, there is a juridical possession. In a contract of bailment, mutum, commodatum. When is there a juridical possession? Mutum. Ano ba yung mutum? Ano yung commodatum? Oh, sige. I presume you know that. But let me just explain. In mutum class, there is a transfer of ownership. Example of a mutum, yung depositary. You deposit your money to the bank. There is a mutum, there is a transfer of ownership. Unlike in a commodatum, there is no transfer of ownership. You have to return the same thing which was loaned to you. There is a juridical obligation, juridical possession, subject of estafa. Trust agreement is basically class a case where there is a juridical possession. Trust receipt law. Remember that in a trust receipt agreement class, it is not a contract of loan. It is not a contract of loan where the relationship of the trustor and the trustee becomes a creditor and a debtor. Creditor and debtor. Of course, you know what is a trust receipt agreement. Of course, you know that. If I will explain all of these things, I might be going over your civil law, right? Civil law. Usufructuary, the usufruct, also is a juridical possession acquired. There is a juridical possession acquired. The pledge in a contract of pledge. But supposing you instructed your driver to pledge your ring, and that ring was not pledged but sold, is there a juridical possession acquired by your driver? No. That is not, he is not the pledgee. But he was only authorized to take delivery of this ring to the pawn shop. Hence, there is only physical possession and not a juridical possession. It is only class in this kind of estafa, 1B, where there is a necessity of determining this juridical or physical possession. In all other cases, especially more so, if there is fraud or deceit, forget about juridical possession. Forget about juridical possession. Question, is there a need for a demand before the accused could be held liable for estafa? The prevailing jurisprudence now class is that demand is not necessary so long as the offended party can prove that there is a misappropriation or appropriation of the property subject of the offense. And misappropriation has been defined by the Supreme Court as any act contrary to the agreement of the party. So long as it was used for another purpose, for a purpose not intended, or for the purpose which was not agreed upon, there is a case of misappropriation.
But then, what is the reason why there is a demand? The reason is to establish a presumption. If there is no direct evidence, class, there is no direct evidence of misappropriation, then you make a demand so that you can establish a presumption that this property subject matter of defense was misappropriated. Example, if the property was already sold to another person, there is no need for a demand. There is no need for a demand. If there was a demand, and then there was a novation of the agreement of the parties, the incipient criminal liability did not arise, and therefore that novation will effectively change or modify the relationship of the parties and will not give rise to a crime of estapa. So long as that novation was done before the filing of the case, that will not, appropriation will not give rise to a crime of estapa. Why? Because the relationship is now of a juridical possession, but it becomes a possession by an owner. Hence, there is only a civil liability. That is the only time that there is at least the liability is already novated, that a crime of estapa can no longer be sustained. Because novation under Article 89 is not among the grounds for extinction of criminal liability. Okay? It merely novated the relationship of the parties. Hence, the juridical possession will now be obliterated. Very good. Fraud and deceit. 2A is the generic misrepresentation, fraud, possessing power, etc. in crimes of illegal recruitment. That is the article applied to A. I will not discuss C anymore. Delivery of a blank instrument. Okay, you can take care of that. When it was filled up by the accused, that is a clear case of abuse of confidence. I will take up 2D especially. What is 2D? It involves the issuance of a check, post-dated, dated, simultaneously, so that the issuance of the check is in consideration of the giving of the property, the offended party parted with his property because of the check. The fraud or deceit existed simultaneously with the exchange. If it did not exist simultaneously, there is no, either before or simultaneously, then it cannot be a crime of estapa. In one case, class, the check was delivered the following day after the property was delivered. The check was considered as a payment of a pre-existing obligation. The property was not delivered anymore because of the issuance of the check, because it was issued subsequently. All right. The law provides issuance of a check. Therefore, only the drawer or the issuer is liable. An endorser is not liable unless he is in cahoots or in conspiracy with the issuer or drawer. Then you may still apply paragraph 2D. But supposing it was the endorser who issued the check simultaneously with the taking of the property, it will not be a crime of estafa under 2D, but it may fall under 2A. 2A, possessing power, fraud involving the misrepresentation by the endorser. 2A ang mag-apply. Okay, 2A ang mag-apply. Question: is demand necessary under 2D? The Supreme Court said, just like any other kind of estafa involving fraud or deceit, demand is not necessary. Again, demand is necessary only for the purpose of the presumption that at the time the check was issued, the accused issuer has no fund or no account in the bank. So that it can, if it can be proven that at the time of the negotiation, the check already has a closed account, no need for a demand, but estafa can already be filed. Nonetheless, class, despite if after the demand there was payment, then there is no crime of estafa. You do not need to prove that at the time of the issuance of the check, the accused knows that he has no fund in the bank. Unlike yana, in BP 22, you need to prove that at the time of the issuance of the check, the accused knows that he has no fund or he has insufficient. The law says insufficient fund. And that when deposited, it was dishonored. In BP 22 class, demand is indispensable. Why? Because if the accused make a payment, the issuer makes a payment, then the liability is abated. The requisite under BP 22 is more stringent because this is a mala prohibita. Malum prohibitum. Okay? Mali yung mala prohibitum. Okay? Malum prohibitum. Alright. It is indispensable that a demand be made to the issuer. And this demand must be received by the issuer, and from that time of receipt, the 5 days will commence to run. The Supreme Court said it is not enough that the receipt, registry receipt, is attached or shown as an evidence. No, not even the receipt of the issuer signed. The receipt signed by the issuer, that is not sufficient. What is necessary, class, is that such receipt be authenticated, meaning that the issuer actually received such notice. All right, such notice. The check, 1, 2, 3 checks were issued. First check, bounce. Presented for payment, it bounce. Account, close. All right. Second check, again, account, close. The issuer was notified. As regards the first check, account close. Second, third check, account close. No demand was made because the payee already assumed. Question, may the accused issuer be held liable for second, third? Of course, the prosecution said, first check already was dishonored and dishonored because of a closed account. So it is already useless that we send him a demand as regards the second and third notice and second and third check. The Supreme Court said, no. Demand is still necessary even if there was a previous notation that the account is closed. Why? Because if the accused pays, walang liability. You see? Walang liability. Ito na ngayon, sabi ng accused. The reason why the check was dishonored is due to a closed account. No account. BP 22 says that there is a violation if the cause of dishonor is insufficient fund. Applying the strict interpretation of a penal statute, insufficient fund is different from a closed account. I should not be held liable. Ano sabi ng Supreme Court? No. That is an absurd reasoning. Why? Because the word insufficient is broad enough to include a no account or no money at all. Here comes the accused again, invoking. The check was deposited beyond the 90-day period. Of course, you know that the check has a lifetime of 6 months. The facts showed that the accused, when the check matured, the accused told the payee, pare, medyo mahirap ang negosyo. Pwede ba next month mo na i-incash? Okay. 30 days thereafter, pare, isang buwan pa, kasi yung shipment bukas as next month pa darating. Sigurado yan. Okay. Third month, ando na pare. Kaya lang may mga papeles, mahirap sa customs na ilalabas. Last 3 months. Last 1 month. So 3 months, 90 days had lapsed. And after the 90 days, the payee deposited the check. And then the accused said, oh, I'm not liable. You did not deposit the check within the 90-day period. You should have deposited the check within the 90-day period. Why should you make me liable under BP 22? Otherwise, is that correct? Of course, the Supreme Court said no. The reason why the check must be deposited within the 90-day period is to create the presumption that the accused knows that at the time the check was issued, there was no fund. Hence, if it can be proven by other evidence that the accused knows that he has no fund at the time he issued the check, then he will still be liable. Galing ang Supreme Court, see? So, hindi pwedeng lukohin. Okay? This kind of so many absurd arguments. Okay? Masyado na naman tahimik. Okay? Let's have a break.